designing for dialogue. How do we design physical spaces like this room we're in, and how do we design virtual spaces to make it possible for people to discuss things, write government policy, learn things, all that sort of stuff. So, let me just see if I can remember where I put my notes. I thought we'd start at the ancient Greek site of Delphi. Because I was just thrust into the limelight here, I'm a complete mental blank and can't remember where I put my notes. Let's see. Learning.
You need to look at Oracle for Delphi.
I need an Oracle for Delphi. Delphi. Learning.
You started?
Yeah, I've started. I just can't remember where I kept my slides. Let me just start. Okay, publications. Finally. Okay, I prepared some notes. There's lots of complicated notes for a more complicated talk, but let's get the simple version. Assuming the slides work, thank goodness for that. Okay, people have discussions in all sorts of strange places. Here's one of the strangest ones that I once had a talk in. Whoops. That picture there, the little picture, you can see it. That is the Joint Operations Command Center of the USS Blue Ridge, flagship of the United States 7th Fleet in the Pacific. We had a meeting of IT people there. It's unusual in that all the walls and floors and ceiling are painted grey and made of steel. But in other respects, it's a group of people sitting around a table talking about things. There's a very old-fashioned video projector on the roof, which didn't get used that much. But the main thing about that was there were people talking. What normally happened down the other end of the room was these people view image. What kind of image? Oh, here we go. I'm trying to get a big picture of this image. Okay, we'll have to look at a little picture of the image. The other end of the same room, there are a whole lot of people in funny uniforms sitting at computers running a war. In this case, it was a simulated war, thankfully, off the coast of Queensland. And the point about that is it looks very military, very Top Gun, that sort of thing, but these are still people sitting there communicating with people. It's just they're using computers and telephones and things. These two functions were combined at opposite ends of the same room. And normally you would think this is a military organisation. Normally there's a general admiral, he issues orders, everybody else salutes and obeys. But in practice, it's not like that. People get around in groups, find out what's going on, come to a decision, and then probably the admiral then stamps the decision as being his order. But it's a discussion sort of forum, in essence. Here's a very old such forum. The ancient theatre of Delphi in Greece, which was once regarded as the centre of the world, spiritually and physically, a large amphitheatre carved out of the natural rock, seats about 5,000 people in a horseshoe shape. And if you look at the room you're sitting in right now, it is the same shape and is derived from that same sort of design. Larger theatres like this were used for entertainment. Smaller ones were used for democracy, where all of the citizens in a relatively small place could get together and make decisions jointly. Of course, these were the citizens who weren't slaves, and that was a small proportion of the population.
All women.
All women. And in fact, women weren't permitted in this area at all, except for the Oracle. The point was that was designed so people could communicate and see people clearly. The other part of that site further down, the photo below that, is the ancient gymnasium, which was a running track. It also had a covered walkway where philosophers used to conduct education. And if you go to the ANU Sports Centre, there is a covered walkway where people like myself who are lecturers at the ANU sit down and gossip about the students and conduct education. In a way, nothing's changed in thousands of years except we have web access there now. And here's an ancient Greek scribe using a tablet computer of the day. It's a wax tablet, and it looks remarkably, size-wise, like a laptop computer or something like that.
That's evidence of aliens, obviously.
Yeah. The point of that is the technology that's used has changed, but the physical design of these things is the same because people haven't changed that much. Today we have systems such as the Purple People Cafe at the ANU, where people discuss things and gossip about things and formally make decisions. This other photo here is the Asia Pacific Hall of the Morris J. Works Centre for Dialogue, Simon Fraser University. This is a purpose-built large version of the room you're in, designed for the community to come together and discuss issues and talk about what to do. Behind all that now, we can use technology. I'll just end by saying, behind all that, in such facilities now, you have Wi-Fi, and my suggestion is we can use the same systems that places like this university use, which are used for education, online, where people get together in forums and discuss things and learn things and debate things. We can use them now for public dialogue, for policy preparations, for making decisions, and for running things that could be as small as a body corporate at your block of flats, all the way up to the nation. And how do we do that? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Would you like a web page?
No, I'm just going to talk. Hi everyone, I'm Pia. So I guess the first thing I want to jump into was, I should say I work for a politician, but I'm not here representing politics or government, and everything the government does is not my personal fault. Now that we've got that out of the way.
I'll just show random web pages about you.
Oh, crap.
All right. I know which
one it is. Well, I don't have my tiara here today either. It's not condoned. Anyway, so the whole point about it's really important to ask the question. You're distracted from my talk. It's really important to ask the question, what's the point of having public consultation? Because, you know, going back to those days, in a way, it was actually the point of it was to reinforce the world of the very few people that were allowed to have a voice, right? But now we have the technologies to actually have everyone participate in the conversation. How do we do that in a meaningful way? Why would we want to do it in the first place? When I came to start to work for the Senator, and given that my background is very much in the open source arena, and I'm used to people being able to be personally empowered to actually do cool stuff, and to just get on and do it in a very meritocratic sort of way, we sort of looked at, okay, well, how can we actually apply some of those perspectives to government? Why would we want to do it? Okay, well, when you actually look at it, there is a huge community out there. Issues that come up now can come up very fast and very, very large, very quickly. And so you want to be able to leverage the best skills, the best information, the experience of the entire community to be able to better respond to and deal with challenges that we have. Stop typing! Oh my God! So you want to have that information not only influence and give you the ability to respond better to challenges, but it helps you inform better policy design and also better policy implementation. It's not just about coming up with, you know, what the policy is going to look like, but through the actual implementation of the policy. If you've got a policy that says we're going to create a new road through this street, and you actually ask the people that live in the surrounding streets, they might be able to say, well, look, that all looks good on paper, and we're glad your architect said that, but we actually all drive to work that way, so why would you want to put one through the road that way? So it's about tapping into not just the expertise of, you know, experts in the field, but the experience of the people who are going to be affected by whatever your policy is going to do. So there's a couple of things there. You need to be able to have, and the whole concept about what we've done with Public Sphere, of which there's papers online, and I'll tweet a few links to them later if you're interested, but the whole point was to create genuine, low barrier to entry, inclusive and well-researched community development, public consultations. Not just going to the traditional stakeholders and getting the normal traditional voices to give you the normal traditional fluffy language. You want to actually get, you know, as much perspective and input as you can. Then you start to have a bit of challenge around data analysis. Now, one of the things that we quickly found with consultations that we've been doing, and we've only done sort of three or four, and we've got a couple more planned for this year that will be announced quite soon, But we're really trying to push the envelope a bit on how to engage people online, how to do it in an open and transparent way, how to make it so that you've got not only good data analysis, but good relationship analysis. If, you know, 90% of the people that responded to this particular topic said that it's a really bad idea, you know, that's a data point and that's interesting. But if you can say, well, actually 80% of those people all work at the same lobby company, now you've got a bit of context to actually help you understand that data. And weirdly enough, we do have a lot of people coming to us in government and trying to influence our perspectives, and so it's useful to have that context around what's being said. The second part of it is, if you can actually take all the information that you're being given from in government, put it out there publicly, and give people a chance to actually review it, do that peer review, rather than stuff going into a black hole, you create a policy, a new policy, and saying, look at what we've done. If you can actually have that peer review of the input as it's coming in, then you're going to have a better chance to be able to debunk what might be extremely well-written FUD. So it's all about trying to really establish what is actually good data through data analysis, through peer review, through relationship analysis and contextualisation. And trying to get away from that he said, she said sort of approach to the, unfortunately the media has sort of got into, where it's like, well, if scientist A says blah and scientist B said blah, then you make up your own mind. Well, the context is that scientist A is backed by 99% of people and scientist B is, you know, backed by 1% and a few nutters. That context is kind of important. Obviously nothing in particular there. So public sphere, I will tweet some links, but basically what we tried to do was not just do yet another government consultation. We basically went out and said, okay, what are some things that we want to consult on that, and maybe that's obviously not a good start either, but what are some things that we know need consultation of? We went and engaged with the communities of interest in the first instance to help us design the consultation, to help us make sure that it's relevant, to help us make sure that it's something people actually want to contribute on and give input on. You know, you go and you talk to the... You're looking for my... What are you looking for? Looking on the Prezi. Prezi.com.
Prezi.com.
Yep. With a Z. So we did this consultation method, which I won't go into that right now. Last year we have seen, in the last year we've seen a massive upsurge of government consultations in Australia. Now, for a lot of people, open government in Australia isn't moving fast enough, and I'm certainly one of those people. I would like things to go much faster, but as my husband likes to refer to me, I'm like a Ferrari tied to a dinosaur, and every so often the back half of me rips off as I just speed ahead. But it's important to realise that government does move slowly, and it's not because it's bad, it's not because it's full of idiots, it's not because of all the sort of traditional things people like to throw at us. It's actually because... Sorry? Was there a comment?
What does God say?
What's thy answer?
I can't spell.
Yeah, no, you really can't. Alright, so... just one last quick thing. So that there's been, right now, we are in the most exciting time for tech in Australia. Now, my background's 10 years in the IT industry. You know, I've been a geek my entire life. My mum is a geek. You know, I've been in this, enmeshed in this forever. And we are finally beyond the time where technology policy in Australia is what a Telstra doing today. We are actually at a point where technology policy is actually very, very exciting. We've got the open gov stuff, we've got the open data stuff, we've got all kinds of really cool stuff. And in the last year, and I'll have to do a blog post about this, but we've seen so much change in policy. We now have a policy that says government data is a public resource. It is, you know, there is an encouragement to make it public. Creative Commons will become a default. It's really exciting. Really exciting stuff. We have a plan for the public service to be more consultative, to be more out there, to be more engaging. But, you know, there are actual strategies and policies, all that stuff's in place. We've got legislative stuff in place. Now what we need to do is see the culture change, which is going to take a while, but it needs encouragement. What we don't need is for every time there is a small mistake to everyone... When you see someone walking half up the hill, you don't kick them back down. You say,
half the hill to go. When you spend 3 months asking for something...
No, for sure.
Then you're allowed to get in a kick while it's...
No. A kick will never help you. Ever.
Never.
I can kick people up hills.
Sure,